Thank you all for coming. I'm Eric Gruen, Executive Director of the New York Technology Council. Welcome to tonight's event. This is the third in a three-part series we're doing with GILT. I know some of you have been to the previous ones, and they've been great, and I'm sure tonight will be equally good. Tonight, Susan Thomas is going to talk about communications gap between product managers and the rest of the world, and presumably what can be done to minimize them. But first, let me talk. Something got lost in translation on this slide.
Oops, sorry.
We're the New York Technology Council. We're a nonprofit. We work with the tech community in New York, trying to bring everyone together and exchange ideas, teach each other. We have a number of sponsors. As trite as it might sound, we would not be here without them. We count on them for our support. They provide the majority of the funds that we need to do what we do. And we thank them for their support. I want to thank GILT for their use of their space tonight. You've all got programs, so I'm not going to go through Susan Thomas's entire life history. More important to turn the microphone over to her. But we're delighted to be here at GILT tonight and have her as our speaker.
Thank you.
Susan.
Yes.
Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate this. This is the first time that I've ever talked about this topic, so you guys are my official test bed for some of the inspirations that have kind of brought me here today. So just a little bit of background about myself. I started out in the computer age, interested in the internet, and I really wanted to be into computers somehow. So I decided that the only way to do that is to be an engineer. So I started there. I was in the engineer space for a while. Actually, I started here at GILT as an engineer and grew to be a lead engineer for one of our initiatives. But I've always struggled. I've struggled to make the decision between, I've always been asked to make the decision to be technical or affiliated with the business. So you make the choice. You have to choose. And I never quite understood why I had to do that, because I really liked being in the middle. I thought it was really interesting. It's kind of a really cool place to be. So I said to myself, okay, well, you know, I'll find my path. So now comes the not so fun part. I started at GILT and working on a project that some could say failed epically. We worked on it for 2 years. I came in towards the end, so it's maybe not my fault. But maybe we'll argue, I don't know. But so I had a choice. I could choose to stay here and be in the middle between being an engineer or being, you know, on the other side, if you will, or in the middle, and or move on. So I decided to stay because I'm really passionate about figuring out what the balance of being in that middle space. So I said to myself, well, why did it fail? Why did this fail? And so I kind of sent myself on a journey, and a few other people helped me and told me to read this book. And she's not here today, but she told me to read this book, and she said, you know, try it out. Some interesting concepts. So that's what inspired me to talk in front of you today. So thank you all for coming. So my inspiration is the hot dog stand. What does that have to do with anything, right? So in this book by Jason Fried, it's called Rework, talks about the concept of creating a hot dog stand. And actually, before I start, has anybody in the room been a part of a failed project? Seen it fail? Wow, there's a lot of hands. So we all know that we can do better, right? So this concept of the hot dog stand is pretty interesting. He talks about how to start one. So does anyone have any idea of the things we would need to start a hot dog stand?
I guess a license.
A license, okay. Anybody else? Hot dogs, okay. Anybody else?
Stand.
A stand, okay. So, yep.
A quarter,
okay. Well, as you know, in New York, we have a lot of hot dog stands, so there's gotta be some success, right? But really, in the book, he talks about having a good hot dog. And if you don't have a good hot dog, the hot dog stand's not gonna really be successful. So it's really an interesting concept because I thought about this and it really resonated with me because why did my project fail? You know? What was the hot dog in that project? What were we actually trying to solve? And then I realized really quickly, I had no idea. I didn't know what we were trying to solve. So that was a really interesting concept for me and really what inspired me to stand here today and talk about the New York hot dog stand. So, what's Gilt's Hot Dog? So we want to be the hub of luxury e-commerce. So that's our hot dog. Some of the things that we do around it, very interesting concepts, but essentially, how do we make the hot dog here at Gilt? So some of the core values that we value, that we really hold dear to us, is the concept of trust. So Gilt really is empowering our employees to, or our cookers in the hot dog concept, to really be able to make their own decisions and really trust the people that you work for. I don't know if anyone heard Mike Brzezik in the beginning of this series, but he talked about the concept of trust. And it's a really interesting one because we really want to have our engineers and our teams really being able to develop in an autonomous way. So really empowering them to make their own decisions is really an interesting concept. But the idea also of decentralization, being able to really diversify how we develop and really kind of be able to make our own decisions in this really diversified way, right? So decentralized, essentially. But can we really, what does that bring, right? So yeah, there's some really interesting concepts around that, but we still have this concept of centralization. We still want to know what everybody's doing, right? So that's always really the hard part around some of our values. So we've got challenges in the kitchen, yeah? We have lots of cooks, we have a lot of things to do, and we have this business model. We're constantly, it's the constant evolution, right? So Gilt started 5 years ago, but we have so many things to do, and we've got so many business models that we want to be able to support. So our business is moving at such a rapid pace. So the projects that my failed two-year project failed probably because it took too long. Our business model changed. We wanted new things. Our hot dog changed, if you will. So we really couldn't be able to be that successful because everything was evolving around us, and we had really big things to do, but really hard to manage across all of our teams. So this is before, with a couple of things we tried to make it better in the past was this concept of the pod model and really projects organized by demand, right? So we say we have this demand, we have this initiative, how can we really organize projects around this initiative? So we would have a business owner tied to an initiative, and we'd have a tech team around the initiative, and we'd work on it. But the problem in that model was that we were operating and developing in silos. So one team, one pod didn't know what the other pod was doing. Eventually this pod was stepping on this pod's toes. So it got to be a little definitely hard to manage and didn't really solve our problem. So then we had this concept of a swagathon. Does anybody know what a swag is? Silly, wild, ask yes. So we had these swagathons. And they really weren't that too far off from these pod models, but really what it did was it brought the tech team into these estimation sessions. So what happened was where we found ourselves were the lead engineers were constantly estimating the work that we were trying to do. And because the business was evolving at such a rapid pace, we couldn't keep up. It was somewhat hard to manage because it just at the end of it all, you know, we're still where we were before. We couldn't develop. We couldn't get things done really quick. So we had the same problems. But now with these same problems, you add churn, chaos, demand, vicious cycle of estimating, and we just figured there had to have been a better way. So introducing the PMO. So of course, everybody hears PMO and they say, oh, lots of things that they're gonna, roadblocks. Oh yeah, lots of things, you know. But really, the way that we see it is at Gilt, is the PMO is the brain, the central nervous system, of the central nervous system, right? So it has these tentacles in each of the projects and things that we're working on, the initiatives that we're driving towards. And what we're really trying to do in the PMO is be a place where all the knowledge is stored. So we'd have an idea of what everybody's doing, a way to centralize in a decentralized world that we live in at Gilt. So that's what the concept is of the PMO. Now, obviously, I don't know where everybody has come from in terms of businesses and their varying levels of PMOs, but I know I've been a part of a PMO. I used to be a project manager, a program manager at corporations that really what my role was to book meetings, align resources, figure out budget, track time, take notes, state status updates. That was really what I was left to do. It really left a bad taste in my mouth around being in the PMO. I didn't want to do that again. But here it's different. What do? So we actually, each one of us in the PMO, whether we're project managers, business system managers, program managers, however which way you look at it, the title really doesn't matter here. But we're subject matter experts. When we are tied to an initiative, we actually become experts at that initiative. We know what the tech teams are doing. We know what the businesses want. We are asking the right questions. So we're able to do that and let the engineer code. Let him do what he does, or her. I used to be there. Best, you know, let them do what they do best. Let the PMO implant in that initiative be the expert. So really what that person has to do has to really partner with tech. So really play a really important role next to that tech lead in that initiative. And also not really, we don't want to drive by word of mouth, but rather we want to drive by the data that we look at. So have you ever had it where, I had this problem actually, it's interesting. Somebody said, well, we have this problem. We procure inventory a certain way. We buy inventory a certain way. And I said, okay, well, how often do we do that? Oh, all the time. All the time. This is a big deal for us, right? But actually I took that and I said, okay, figure it out, I'll get back to you. So what I did was I really dove into the analytics of things. And I said, what are we really doing, you know? And it turned out that person actually was wrong. Not a surprise, right? So if I listened and I just kind of went down that road and didn't look at the data, I would have been in this edge case somewhere off in left field. So I actually look at the data, and it's so important because the devil's in the data, if you will. And so what else we do at the PMO is we drive, right? So we basically keep that idea in mind. The PMO keeps that idea in mind, and we say, okay, what are we actually driving towards? What's Gilt's hot dog? We always keep that eye on how Gilt wants to move forward and the evolution of the business model. So we really are focusing in on that and driving the team towards that goal. And always asking, is this our hot dog? So is this really what we're trying to do? So how do we do it? Sounds great, right? And easy. Defining the hot dog, it sounds really easy, right? So I kind of broke it down into some steps because I felt like as I was going through these problems, how do we really figure it out? So the business has this big initiative. We want to roll out a new system. Okay, well why? why do we want to roll out the system? So the first thing is, business has an initiative, but we really define it. So what is it really? What are the problems we're really trying to solve? They could say, well, I want to roll out a new system. I don't like the old one. But what are we really trying to solve? What are the real reasons behind bringing a technology in? People say, oh, I want to roll out a new CRM package because we need to get better control of our contacts. But what really are the problem? We don't have an idea of what each one of our contacts are in our customer management system. So getting the business to really buy into why we're putting money behind the initiative is really important on everything that we do. So then we kind of split out. We say, okay, continue to talk to the business, find out what their true problems are, but then let's take that information around that those problems and go back to the tech teams, go back to the engineers and say, hey, you know, these are the guide rails of where we're going with this. What are the problems you see? What are the things you want to fix? What are your requirements? We lose that, you know? We lose that. We often say, well, what's the business want? What's the business want? Well, the tech team has needs too. The engineers have needs. What do they need? We always sometimes lose sight of that. So the next question is, we kind of come back together and we say, well, what do we do today? What are the problems we do today? And we ask the questions, right? Everyone says, well, this is what we do today. And, you know, back to my thing, you know, well, this is how I procure inventory, so this is what we do. But really understand it, right? So we analyze it, we look at the data, we say, okay, that makes sense. How do we tackle this problem? What are we doing today that's causing it to be a problem? And then what I do, what's interesting, is that I draw it. Because there's really two ways that people, you know, a lot of ways that people ingest information, but a lot of times I'm seeing, you know, being visual really helps. So I draw it out, kind of like in a diagram, somewhat like this, nothing fancy, but just keeping it really simple and to the point. And then I define it again. I define the problem again. I say, okay, well, now we thought this big initiative, we defined it first, now we really figured out what the problem is today, so we define it again. Because it may not be what we thought it was initially, right? And then I define what it's not. Because now that we've got these guide rails up and we say what it is, a lot of people want to be able to put more things in. Keep wanting to put things in. Well, no, it's not this, and it's not that, and it's not what you're looking for here. It's not this procurement model. It's not what you're trying to do. Here are the things that it's not. So that's the next step there. And then we define what it is, what it's not. We draw it. We take that whole package of stuff, and we socialize it. We socialize it to the business teams. We socialize it to the tech teams. We start to really get the word out. We start to define those executable chunks of work, right? It's not this large, lofty initiative where everybody can throw everything in the basket and say, oh yeah, that in the kitchen sink, you know, that's supposed to be solved in this initiative, and that's supposed to be solved in that initiative, you know? It's a way to really say what it is, what it's not, draw it, here it is. Plain black and white, as simple as day, really distill it down and really drive consensus. So this way we can execute in a really, really focused way, simple, really simple. It's really hard to do because we really want to try to be able to get as much out of it as possible, but it's really these steps. It's pretty simple. So communication, right? So now we're in the PMO. So how do we communicate? Where's our project plan? We don't have one. So we're trying not to do that, right? So we're trying not to get caught up in that, you know, here's where this person is, they're working 7 hours, they're going out to lunch, they're taking the hour, they're figuring out, you know, think about how much time we spend to keep a project plan up to date. It's crazy. I've been there. It's one of the things that we tried to do in this project that failed, right? So I was part of this project. Thought we had to have this big project plan. Didn't work because there was just too many, things changed too rapidly. So roadmaps are cool, they're okay, you know? But the idea here is that roadmaps are just estimates. really. You know, somebody saying, oh yeah, I think it's going to take 6 months against that initiative that we really didn't define before because we really didn't go through the process of figuring out what the hot dog was. We didn't really figure out what the problems that we were trying to solve. We're just saying we want to roll this out and we think it's going to be this. So roadmaps are all right, but as long as everybody understands they're just guesses. We have this idea of KPIs. So concept here is that we have things that we would like to solve, measurable things we want to fix and problems. So for example, big initiative, we want to roll out a new customer service app, let's say for example. One of the KPIs would be potentially we would like to lower the amount of calls that we get around discounts and promotions, let's say. Well, then it's really clear for the team to really focus around what we're trying to fix instead of saying we're rolling out a new customer service system, a new app, and throw everything in the bucket. Yeah, we want this. We want this button to be blue. We want this button to be yellow, you know? Everybody kind of focuses on that. But if we had a KPI where we're kind of all around this idea that we want to lower our call volume on discounts and promotions, and we want to see that meter move, right? We want to be able to see that go down and up. So that's the concept of what we're trying to adopt in tech. We've done a lot of it, but I mean, not all teams are around a KPI, but it's definitely one way to go. It's an interesting one because it really gets us to focus in on what are the problems we're trying to solve and what's the hot dog, right? So we're trying to lower those calls. Let's see that meter tick. So it actually brings up something very interesting because you could say, well, how are we doing, right? It provides transparency to the business in a way that they can look at it and say, here's this dashboard, it's up. We actually have a dashboard server. I'm not sure what the address is, but we do have one. And essentially we go there and there's all the KPIs, all the meters. So we're able to see and track how well we're doing against this problem that we have. It's real, it's tangible. We have this problem, we're trying to solve it. How are we doing? And also, it kind of brings us to smaller milestones, right? We're all really focused on this one milestone. And it really, all of these things really just help us build trust in the organization. So as we start to execute and we start to really execute well and we're bringing things out into production because we release constantly, then we're building trust in that we can actually do what we say we're going to do. We're actually going to move that meter. So this helps us, all of these things around focus. No condiments here. So the concept in the book was interesting. People often focus on the mustard and the really cool organic relish. Everyone loves the organic thing. But, you know, even in projects, we have that too. So really either having a KPI or just that problem that we're trying to solve, that distilled problem that everybody can wrap their head around instead of this huge, lofty initiative, we always will, it'll help us actually. It will really help us define the things that we want to consider when we start executing. Do we really want to make that button red? Do we really want to spend that time doing that? Is it really going to move our meter? Is it really the problem we're all trying to solve? So it helps. And this is an interesting quote. People avoid saying no because confrontation makes them uncomfortable. But the alternative is even worse. You drag things out, make things complicated, and work on ideas you don't believe in. So my 2-year project, everybody was really dragged out and not feeling good, feeling like everything was really complicated. And it brings the morale down on the team. So not only does it build, you know, the idea here is that we're focusing and we're building trust, you know, cross-functionally, we're building trust within ourselves and within the team that we're actually making progress. We're making a difference. Not that we're just doing something because we are told we have to. So it's really driving focus. And also, really giving us the ability to say no easily. No, we're not gonna move this ticker on the KPI, so I'm not interested in that. So it's really easy for people to have that to say no against. So focus, what our focus is, what our focus is on the future. Well, we still have lots of problems, but they're going to be, or they are, lots of smaller bodies of work. So we take that big initiative and we distill it down and we break it into the smaller buckets of pieces of executable work. But we'll be able to do it in a way that we can actually continue to build trust. And the idea here is that we'll have continuous improvement. So we're living in this like agile world, right? So everybody, the buzzword is agile. Oh, some people are agile, some people, does everyone know what agile is? Just wanna make sure I understand here. Yeah? So back in the old days, we used to do things in this waterfall way, right? Where we sit down in a room and we have a bunch of requirement sessions that go over months and months and months and months. And then we have this long document and everybody executes to that. So it's, we gather business requirements, we execute, we QA, we release. Well, here, and often, you know, the new thing is agile, right? But everyone's trying to, they're kind of having a hard time adopting it depending on where you are, because it's hard to put in practice. But the concept is that you only gather what you need before you're ready to actually develop and execute, right? So the concept of continuous improvement. So getting these smaller bodies of work, getting them into production, seeing them in production and get instant feedback sooner than you would in this waterfall world. So the continuous improvement's important here. We release often. We get our feedback often, and we are working on smaller bodies of work. But what this also brings is flexibility. So our business model changes. Now we want to do something different. Okay, fine, let's do it. Let's layer it on, you know? Let's just keep improving on the product and keep kind of, by the business is here and we're actually kind of going along with the business in a way that we're pacing each other, we're working together. Instead of it being, you know, we go off and develop in some dark room somewhere and build something amazing, we're actually with them through the entire way. And they're owning it too. But the idea here is that we'll get the feedback quick. So the idea is that we'll fail fast, and we'll probably fail often, but at least we'll know quicker. We'll know quicker as we release things, whether or not it made sense. And it's funny, we talk about this MVP, which is minimal viable product. So what this means is as we release things to production, just because we're continuously improving doesn't mean it buys the engineers this idea, well, we'll just get it out to production and we'll fix it later. The idea is that what we do release to production is awesome. So it's the best stuff. It's the best code we could write against the minimum functionality that we want to release at that time. So the concept is MVP, really, and that's one of the focuses that we have when we release. And I end this like this, right? So if there's anything that you kind of come away with in this talk, is just continue to ask, what are the problems we're actually solving? It's really what it is. I started to do it in practice, and I've really been quite inspired because it's not, sometimes people don't know what the real problem is, but if you ask the question, they'll tell you they don't know, and they'll tell you who to help you figure out, you know, where the problem is and how you'll fix it. So the only thing that I can say is that it's really helped me a lot, and I hope that if there's anything that you got out of this, you'll be thinking about, is this the hot dog we're trying to solve? So I leave that to questions. If anybody has any questions. Yeah.
How do you determine what's big enough to be considered an initiative?
Well, that actually just comes from, you know, the natural budgeting process, right? So business will sit down and say, okay, well, these are the three things we want to focus on. And then those three things, they usually kind of come out to their strategies, you know, different strategic things we want to do. And out of that will come an initiative. And we'll hear that and we'll say, okay, what does that really mean? What are the things we want to solve? What projects are those? What KPIs do we want to build to measure those, whether we're successful on those or not, and how we'll execute?
And related to that, if I can, how many of those initiatives, or how often is it an initiative that goes to sort of development turn out not to be a development issue? In other words, development says, this is really not, we're not going to solve this problem. Somebody else needs to solve it.
Right. So that's really cool that you say that. So I go back. In this process here, we'll figure it out earlier. It's not, we're going to not figure it out when we execute. It's when we start to ask the questions of defining what it really is. So really further up, give ourselves some time to go through this. You know, I've been a consultant. I know you've got to, you know, basically execute quick, fast. But ask the question, is it, you know, what is it really? Define what it is really that we're trying to solve, and you'll get to that really quick. And then you'll say, okay, nope, we still have work to do. We're not ready to execute yet. We don't know enough.
Okay, I think you've identified, let's say you're taking on a new initiative and you have identified your hot dog or what you think is your hot dog. And it goes really well, development, everything flows smoothly, QA, everything's great, push out of production. But it turns out it's the wrong flavor of a hot dog. Like, your customers aren't buying it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, how do you handle that failure within your team?
Yeah, and I guess it's a two-parter, right? So one is does the functionality work?
Mm-hmm.
And so with the idea that we're releasing sooner, we'll get that feedback sooner. So we'll understand, you know, if it failed, okay, well, why? And failure amongst the team is hard. You know, I was part of, my balloon was deflated when we failed. I mean, I wanted to save the day. I wanted to fix it. I wanted to make it better. Everyone that I worked with wanted to make it better. But the idea is that if you aren't on these long projects for 2 years, waiting and waiting and waiting, it builds anticipation. But if you're doing things in smaller chunks and smaller executable pieces of work, then you don't fall so hard. You know, I mean, I fell off that 2 year cliff and oh, that was it. But I didn't fall. You know, you don't fall so hard. So, I hope that answers your question.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, I mean, usually with a minimum viable product, you only release it to some of your customers, not the whole customer base, because if it does fail spectacularly,
sure,
you can then not release it,
yes,
to the wider customer base. Is that how you do it? I mean, I'm getting the impression that when you release these iterations, that you're releasing them to everybody.
Okay, and fair point. We do definitely A/B testing, for sure. Yeah. I mean, when I say release to production, I mean release to production to someone, right?
Okay.
So it could be a group of people, it could be many people, but,
mm-hmm,
and I also say the idea too is that we're not just releasing for our customers, we're releasing for ourselves. We're our own customer here. You know, we have operations that need things done. I'm not just talking about releasing to our, you know, customer. I'm talking about also releasing things to our internal finance folks. Internal supply chain folks, people at the warehouses, you know what I mean? So we are releasing, we're going through those iterations, but we'll definitely have testing, to your point. That'd be scary.
And one other point, earlier on you talked about not having a project plan and just going with a roadmap, which I think is a wonderful thing, having spent far too much time in my life updating project plans, and you can never ever stay on top of it. But the thing that I find that it's often difficult to get funding without a project plan. So whether it's, even if it's internal sometimes or external funding. So how do you deal with that? I mean, have you run into that problem?
So at the time of funding, it's just an initiative, yeah?
Okay.
So all the way up at the top, it's a couple of bullets on a slide or in an Excel spreadsheet that says, we want to fix this or we want to roll this thing out.
Yeah.
And so roadmaps and estimates and initiatives against estimates against those initiatives, they're just guesses. So we have to be comfortable with the fact that we are budgeting against a guess. It's really what it is.
Mm. Always has to be.
Yeah, yeah, it's really what it is. Mm-hmm. And that could shift, right? But the what we can actually accomplish within the time that we budget for, we really, that's what makes that problem that we're trying to solve so much more important. Because I don't want to spend, if I've, you know, budgeted for 6 months or something like that of development work, I don't want to focus on the button color. I want to focus on solving the problems. So this step becomes really important. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah, in the back, in the blue.
So this framework assumes that people want a hot dog in the first place. So let's assume there's a problem and that they are hungry. How do you validate whether they're hungry for a hot dog or not?
I ask them why, and then I ask them why again. I've actually had that happen.
Asking who?
The person asking, well, what do you mean? Sorry, just go back and...
So I guess my question is, how are you validating whether this is some of this idea is what people want in the first place? So it's validating, going out and validating a new product using words.
Right.
Because asking the customer is not necessarily going to provide the insight.
Oh, you mean the customer, i.e. like the our customer at
right,
Guild?
Whoever you're building for.
Okay. Well, I think it's driven by, I mean, there's a lot of different, I mean, there's that's a good question, but I think there's a lot of questions around, obviously we can't go out and say, hey, customer in New York somewhere, or hopefully somewhere else other than New York, but let's say, and pick up the phone and say, you know, would you like this feature on the website? But I think, you know, based on our analytics, so if we go back to the analytics and we look at that, we'll say whether or not we think that that is actually a viable thing that we may want, right? So if it's a new feature, then obviously it came from somewhere. And we all have ideas, right? Each of our, you know, through the autonomy of our teams, we do have tons of ideas. We have tons of smart people that work here that come up with ideas that say, wouldn't it be great if, or wouldn't it be great to do that? But those teams are kind of focused on around a KPI. So if that feature is going to move the ticker or move that KPI, then it makes sense for them. But if it doesn't, then it, you know, goes to a backlog, or maybe another team may be interested in doing that feature for that KPI. Maybe they have a KPI that that'll be helpful for. So that's kind of where we centralize some of that knowledge and understand the features and really be able to ask the question, why?
So if you can elaborate on that, so can you talk about specifically the Guild, what are some like metrics by which you would evaluate that this is a good idea rather than it just being simply an idea? Sort of this concept of like pirate metrics is going around a lot.
Right, so the idea of like a new feature or something
right.
like that?
It seems like a good idea, but so.
Well, that's part of the reason why it's MVP, right? So minimal viable product, right? And the concept of releasing, back to your point, into a test group to see if it actually works, right? So recently we rolled out PayPal, and we rolled it out to a small group to see if it would even stick. And we analyzed the data. And so there's that constant process there, but you know, that's why we really focus in on the things we want to solve, that minimal viable product, releasing it, getting feedback sooner through the test, through our A/B testing, seeing if it's sticking, seeing if we get the lift we think, and then maybe doing something more to it. Hope that answers your question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Did you stick with it?
I don't know. Yeah.
I have a related question now. So do you actually engage the customer as far as getting feedback from the customer's concerned? Or is it just the internal teams?
Right. You know, I'm not sure, actually. I wish I could tell you one way or the other, but I think we actually, I mean, I know we look at our data. We look at definitely our analytics, and we see how it's behaving. But I'm sure, you know, we definitely do reach out to some customers to see how they're doing.
So
like
you could save time, but instead of looking at data all the time, you could do customer engagement.
Yeah, we do some of that.
With
agile, and you know, when you are, you said you don't do project plans, which, you know,
scary place.
Yeah, scary place.
It's hard for people to get.
With agile, typically you're, you know, setting aside a certain number of resources, but you're not sure how, you know, what you're going to get done. Is that the way you are doing this? You sort of swag it and say, well, we think this is a six-person team, and we hope that they'll get this done in 6 months, but.
Right. What we do is we actually take the concept of, you know, being in an agile world, right? It's really hard to know when things are, when things will be done, right? But we're really being able to see how what the team is focusing on based on those KPIs that we're really looking at, right? So we're seeing those problems being solved. So as long as the problems are being solved, then we're doing good, right? So it's the concept of that, kind of decoupling ourselves from time and this hard deadline versus, you know, really kind of driving towards fixing problems. If that helps. Any other questions? Yes.
How do you go about determining what is a desirable outcome for a particular release, you know, with your within your test groups and whatever, you know, what kind of adoption level? Presumably there would be a go kill decision somewhere along the line that this is, yeah, this has succeeded to a certain degree, but we feel that we could actually do something better.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you reach those decisions?
Who makes
those?
Right. So I guess it's really a couple of points there. Is really around the A/B testing. So what we're looking for specifically, it could be, you know, when we go into it, we say, well, these are the metrics we're looking at. These are the things that we care about the most.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially, you know, the business is really driving that, right? Because it's features that are really going to be promoting, you know, let's say revenue or things like that, or lift.
Mm-hmm.
Or so that would be, those are the people that really define that. And then really just getting, our, you know, a pulse on that at each step. So we may release to 25% of our customers and say, well, the next release we probably want to do a little bit. Let's try this other thing, or let's try to make it better. So the idea is like the constant release and being able to really put our finger on the data that we want. We specify the metrics that are important to us before we start the A/B test.
The method that you're talking about seems best suited towards incremental changes that are cumulatively could be very large, but by themselves are pretty small. But sometimes, like if you want to get to the moon, you can't do it incrementally, you can't build a better airplane. So how do you guys tackle larger initiatives that can't be done in an incremental fashion?
So could you give me an example?
An example might be, let's say PayPal as an example.
Right.
To me, that seems like a pretty large, it's not a huge initiative, but it's not insignificant either. And so to use that as a small test, and you know, whether you roll it out to 25 or 50 people really doesn't matter so much other than you know that they want it, maybe to tweak it. But to get to that point could be a large initiative, could take you a while.
Right. So the concept is being able to break it down into small executable pieces, right? So even if it's really large, developing in an iterative way to get us to that point, you know, it may be that at the end of that iteration, we may not release. We may be just kind of iterating and focusing on getting us to that point where we can.
Let's say you want to start selling live goods.
I'm sorry?
Live goods. You wanted to sell live plants.
Okay.
So that's a refit to your warehouse. I mean, there's a lot involved.
Sure. Sure, there is. There's a lot involved. But you know the questions I would ask? Okay, so we want to sell plants. Well, can we, you know, what are the questions that I have around that? Well, can our warehouses support it? Can we distribute it in time? So I'd start to build the questions that I would ask the business if my computer was up, but in the box where I say, you know, ask the business the questions, you know, I would come up with those questions if whether or not we can support it. I mean, obviously if it became an initiative, right, if it came down that funnel, then we kind of know we can kind of do it, but there'll probably be some changes along the way, right? Because the idea is that
business folks are giving us those initiatives and really being able to feed in that input to say, we want to sell live plants. That's that big thing. And then say, okay, well, that's great. We want to sell live plants. What does that mean? You know? And then just start asking the questions about, you know, well, okay, well, do we have, like I said, do we have a warehouse? Do we have the ability to sell them? Do we have some laws? Is there some law involved around selling plants? Do we have to get them out soon enough? I mean, so then you start building these questions and then you start assigning people to those questions, those answers before we even execute, because those things will stump us later. People will have them in their head.
But how is that any different than the initial design process in the waterfall? And that's, I think, is this question. Because that is what you do in the waterfall, is you go through that exact process you just described, talking to people, laying out what you think, what the various issues
yeah.
are, and trying to design a system that will actually work to do this. It's laying out a roadmap.
Okay.
You're not trying to solve every individual problem.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay. Point taken. However, the way that I would do it is maybe I wouldn't ask all of those questions first, because maybe I would think about how we would receive in plants. Like, how would we buy them? And I would look at starting at the start of the process, we buy plants. Okay, can we support buying the plant? To ask those questions. Okay, the answer is yes. Okay, let's start building buying plants. Do you see what I mean? And then now we're saying, okay, well, can we receive in plants? You know, I mean, obviously we know along the way that we can support it. So the idea is to gain consensus around those buckets and doing some information gathering to validate whether or not we think we could do it, right? So then we get to that execute stage, but we're only executing on buying the plant, right? And then the next stage, we're gonna ask and go dive into the details around what it would mean to receive it.
So now you have a system that you can, I'm not trying to be funny, now you're buying a whole bunch of plants and you have no way to sell them, okay? After a while, plants will die.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, especially if you don't have to wait to water them and keep them alive.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, it's there's at least something to be said for these big projects. I think this is a perfect thing, and I think the a lot of these things now are basically looking at that evolutionary styles like Agile are really good for moving things in a good path.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, making them better and making them better. Constantly making them better, because you don't need to do large planning in big chunks. That's actually harder to do. However, there are some jumps that you can do better if you actually can plan.
Right.
Okay.
So
and that was this question. I think is how do you handle that those different types of projects?
So this inspiration for me, although I talk about Agile, okay. I do know that maybe it might not work for everybody, but the concept of my talk is actually about knowing what problems we're solving. So it, however you execute, okay, whether you execute in this big way or this small way, and the small way is obviously something that we prefer here because it works for us, but it's really being able to ask the questions we're actually trying to solve. I've been in so many situations that we really don't know. We're being asked to execute something. We're being asked to roll out the airplane. We're being asked to buy plants. But we really don't know what problems we're trying to solve. Why do we want to sell plants? Why do we think we want to sell plants? It's about asking the question of what we actually are trying to solve. What are the problems we're actually trying to solve? That's what I'm trying to say, is that having transparency into that will really be able to drive a clear execution and really guide the team and really put up those guardrails around what we, you know, really, really keep us in that zone, that focus, so we don't go all over the place and scope creep everywhere and it becomes crazy. And a two-year project falling off the two-year cliff, sadly. I'm still alive, though. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate you hearing this talk. It's been a really fun night, so thank you so much for coming out. I really do appreciate that.